and John Lustig. John Lustig is the director of our Lockport location, Illinois State Museum Lockport Gallery, who brought Julia Hall in today for this exhibition, and I'm going to be talking to Julia about her work this afternoon. This is part of an exhibition called Focus 4, which is four artists brought in by four of our curators, essentially four independent solo shows. We don't necessarily know how they're going to land once they come in here, so it's always interesting to find the connections and parallels between the work, and it's always a real delight to be introduced to an artist that many of us maybe have seen but did not know the work in depth. And hopefully we'll have the opportunity this afternoon to explore Julia's work a little bit more closely and more in depth, get your perspective on it. But I want to introduce John Lustig, who's our new director of our Lockport Gallery, and he's going to take it from here. And also, feel free to squeeze it a little bit. We'll have people coming in. We have, it's all right to sit close to each other, hopefully, you know, so we can make room for people who are coming. But John, take it away.
Good afternoon. Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming out on the weather today. It's a privilege. It's a privilege to talk about art, to introduce an artist to the community, and also try and make some connections. We work all around the state, all of us as an institution, to try and find some harmony with the artwork that we look at and talk about. I want to give a quick plug, if you'll allow me, for my Lockport site. We have an opening on Friday. Jason Brommer, who is a local artist, he's doing a mural for us right now. And so if you're so inclined, we have cards up there. And feel free to indulge.
How long a drive is it?
Sorry?
How long a drive is it?
It's 35 miles.
Yeah.
But there's plenty of good food and great booze. as we like to say. And great art. So I wanted to, as I walked into this exercise of Focus 4, and being away professionally for almost 13 years, I'm from Chicago. I studied here. I wanted to see some causal connections from being away professionally. And coming back and being invited to participate in this exercise, I wanted to see what was going on. When I left in 2001, it was the apartment gallery scene, right? So when I came back and started looking and doing research, there was something else going on. There was another wave, another generation of artists doing happenings and drawing some light and drawing some critical reaction. And Julia's name came to me through an article that we saw in the, should we give them props, New Reader?
The Reader.
And maybe you saw it. There's this big, amazingly aggressive, proactive, in-your-face painting called Power Pussy. And it caught me by surprise to see that this was drawing some attention and it triggered something. It triggered something for me as a student. It triggered something as a student here, and I like to try and make some connections to the continuum of things. And I think many of you will know this artist or this artwork. I'm sure a lot of you remember this painting of Harold Washington by David Nelson. And for right or for wrong, I made a distinct connection between these two images. From the point of not just a literal frontal figure, but I saw these as two very subversive works of art, where they were trying to alter and change the way we think about things. And those of us who were in town remember the controversy and the flame up that it had, covered in the Times and covered in the Journal. But as I look, try to find a screenshot of this, good luck. This image has been retired so many different ways. But this image still attracted me, and I reached out. I reached out to you on Facebook.
No, via email. Or what was it? Yeah, it was Facebook.
It was Facebook. under my assumed pen name. And I was intrigued. I was intrigued in that continuum. And so what I walked into, from seeing this to when I walked into your studio, I was surprised. I went into a different world. I didn't see this empowering statement. I met an artist in a time of her life where you were evaluating.
Yeah, absolutely.
And redrawing and reassessing things. And so that's where I wanted to lead off with this painting, The Ranger's Grave. So would you like to talk about where you were at the point of our contact?
Absolutely. So just being super, super real and upfront, last August, actually last July, July 4th to be exact, a very close friend of mine passed away. He was at the Peninsula with another dear friend of mine, Claire Mollick, and he was having a really nice dinner, a piece of steak, some mashed potatoes, a glass of wine. And it just goes to show how life can really, really flash by, fizzle out, fade out in a matter of seconds. He choked on a piece of steak, underwent cardiac arrest, and ended up going into a coma for about 3 or 4 days. I was in LA at the time when I received the phone call. A good friend of mine had heard the news, and I just did what anyone would. I just cried and kind of lost it for a minute. Actually for a few days and maybe for a few weeks, and you know, sometimes I still feel really, really emotional about it, like right now. So I was also going through this weird period with my art where I was actually very, very bored. If a lot of you are familiar with my earlier work, I used a lot of repetition, and I think that I relied on the method of repetition to kind of carry my work. And it was almost taking over the work itself. I was getting lots of pats on the back. A lot of people really liked it, but I feel like that's a really, really dangerous place to be in when people keep patting you on the back for certain work, because then you'll end up continuing that same work. And yeah, you can keep a certain audience, but what's the point in creating or being an artist if you're not learning constantly? By learning, I just mean learning about the world around you, learning about yourself, and constantly challenging yourself, which is really, really important. So that in conjunction with Jeff's death, I had to get the hell out of Dodge. So I rented my apartment out, and I left for New York for the month of August. And I decided to give up the act of reference. By referencing, I just mean simply looking at an object in order to draw it on a piece of paper. So I gave that up. For a while, I gave up color, and I gave up painting. So I was just using three materials. I was using wax, crayon, pencil, and white Prismacolor. And I don't know if we should start with Ranger's Grave. I think we should start with The Last Meal, which is based on, it's right on the wall behind there. So one night, I'm in New York, I'm scrolling through my phone. A lot of you probably have Instagram. Well, Jeffy's Instagram is still up, and I came across a picture that he took of that very meal that killed him. It was the steak, the wine, the potatoes, and I'm just like, what? I fell into a rabbit hole, and I started thinking about this concept of the last meal, and what that means. And I went to Central Park the very next day, and I cloaked a meal. I don't believe it's here. It was a drawing of just a cloaked meal. So I combined the veiled conversation and a cloaked meal. And that is definitely in honor of my friend Jeff. And he was a huge, huge impetus of this series itself. So in giving that up and going to this uncomfortable space, completely emotionally uncomfortable, and uncomfortable with regard to not referencing, giving up color, kind of recontextualizing who I am as an artist, not being likened to certain artists like Kehinde Wiley and other artists, contemporary artists who are using utilization of repetition in their works, I felt was really, really important. So then as I was walking around New York, I found a stack of books. And this was one of the books that I found on the side of the road. Like, people will just leave stacks on the side of the road. You can take them and do what you will. And so these drawings you'll see that accompany all the works are the very, very first that I started in the entire series. And so I brought the stack of drawings back, and that's when I received your message in my inbox. So I was already kind of like tumbling into this new phase in my career. You caught me at a really, really important, really vulnerable, but really exciting time. You know, I was really shedding my old skin, I think. You know?
Yeah, and my only axiom was I did not want to show card list.
Right? Mine too.
We mutually agreed to that. I had seen right away that she had moved away from that, and that this shock of life had started to affect her. And we started looking at the drawings. We started seeing things in different groups and in different moments. Working on the raw canvas, for example, was a literal reaction to you trying to pare down and to pull back. Do you want to talk about that briefly?
Okay, so after Jeff passed, another reaction to that was I started throwing everything out. Like, I went through my closet, I filled up bags of shoes, clothes, I threw away my couch, I threw away my bed. I'm telling you, I was just going through this crazy reduction period. And it's in the realization that life is so finite. That's a huge part of my work. In every work you'll see here, I think you can connect a sense of loss to it, but not in like a negative or dark sense, even though some of the works may read as dark, but more so in the Buddhist sense that everything is fleeting and passing and ephemeral. So to celebrate in the moment here and now. And so I was stripping away everything. As I said, I threw away a lot of my belongings. And in that, I also threw away the gesso canvas, which can be very sterile at times. And I really wanted to be working in kind of a primitive state. And it felt so good to just work on this like torn up, discarded book. You know, I don't know psychologically what that means about the book, that it will deteriorate over time. It is very much like life. And the raw linen also gave me such a sense of like sense of tact. It was very tactile, and I was working with oil sticks. So, and I was also working on the floor. So I felt a lot more connected with the work than just, like I said, being reliant on a sense of repetition or past methods. You know, it was a really scary but super exciting place.
So you also were working on a series, and we talked about family, we talked about you and your sense of place, again, triggering off of the Power Pussy painting. It was a sense of reclaiming yourself, but you also had these other strains in your work, and so I want to tie this, and then maybe tie it back into the title Western Veil, and talk about this painting, because this was a series. I mean, we could have given you a whole show on this. And it's wonderful work to look at. It's very hard work to look at. But I'll lead you into that, and then maybe see how that rolls back into the title of the Veil as it rolls, if you don't mind.
Absolutely. So, in any major city or anywhere in the entire world, everyone wears veils. The reason for wearing veils isn't negative. It's not positive. It's merely to protect ourselves from being in a constant state of vulnerability. This one here is called The Veil of Memory. This is kind of part three in the series of paintings that I'm doing about my mother's mom, my grams. She's in the later stages of memory deterioration. So I think the hardest part of the whole experience is watching my mom, see her mom go through that. I remember distinctly in 2009, it was Christmas Eve, and she was like, "We gotta go to Ohio. You know, grandma's in the hospital, she fell." And it was the very beginning of this deterioration. And she sat there just watching her mom struggle, remembering her own daughter's name. And there's something so devastating about that, you know? And then my mom's like, "I'm gonna lose my mind." I was like, "No, you're not." I was like, "It skips generations, it's gonna be me." I just made it up. I literally made that up. I don't even know if that's true. But to hear my mom express it was just, it sucks. I mean, you know, but it's also part of human life, and a huge reason for my work is simply to connect empathetically with my audience. That's the most important thing to me. I think my reason for being on this earth and being an artist is to help alleviate some sense of suffering through that empathy. So I'm sure a lot of you, probably 90-95% of you have someone in your life maybe who has undergone memory. It's just hard.
the way you painted them, and then the way you approached the act of painting, I think at this point is worth discussing. I mean, versus your reductive phase versus
right.
actually how you physically
painted
those.
Yeah, this was kind of the bridge between that severe reduction. And the reason why I think this piece has been so successful is because it's easily digestible, meaning it's in a two-piece format. There's only two elements to it. So whereas I was reducing color and taking out context with these two earlier works, or like the first works, I started reintroducing color back into my palette, which felt really, really good, really delicious, and it felt like, okay, now I'm ready to, you know, juice it up again after it chops up and everything. So, yeah, I just think that this piece is, I think it's successful because it's reduced. And then it led into this more metaphorical kind of symbology that I'm leaning into. I don't know if this is necessarily where we keep going. I have no idea. But I think that's part of the beauty of being an artist, is switching it up constantly for yourself.
Clarify the Western Veil, though, as an overarching.
So as an overarching point, as I was saying, every human being wears veils to guard themselves. It could be anywhere from just feeling like weird, awkward, standing in front of an audience, like just feeling uncomfortable, to avoiding, you know, a murderer coming into your home. I mean, we all wear veils, so the whole series itself is just about these ways to protect ourselves, you know?
So can we do tropic flowers? Can we talk about that really quick?
Sure.
Because again, when we talked about, if you weren't familiar with Julia's work, she was employing patterns in the background. She referenced Kino Wildly. And this is the only painting in this exhibit that would even come close to that in this pattern. And I walked in after seeing what I had seen of you, and again, my jaw dropped at the sight of this painting, and meeting her and seeing her, this felt very physical to me. This felt very anchored, almost like a pelvis. It just feels that anchored. And so what I saw, and what's worth commenting on, is again, this following up of this woman who's reclaiming herself and reclaiming her identity from the inside out. And I see these as a pelvis shape. There's a pelvis drawing over there in the corner that's worth noting. But I know you have a metaphor behind, so let me let you have the last word on it.
Okay, so the metaphor of this piece is about the veil of death, in a sense. This is the deadly trumpet flower. So when you ingest it, first you'll froth at the mouth, and then you'll convulse, and then you'll die. There's another name for it, it's called Rumanjia. And so this piece itself is about access to suicide. So we all have suicide at our fingertips. Why some choose to carry that out is extremely personal and extremely harmful to families and friends and anyone in the insular network of people in their life. So it's the veil of suicide, the veil of death.
So at this point, we were talking about having a show, and we were just like, let's come down and check this place out. This is a new space for me. This was a new experience for her. I mean, we went and looked at some art, and we came to a talk. What was the name of the talk that day? That Day in Fate.
Well, that was for the part of the scripture.
Yeah.
Richard Deutsch and Karen Pearl. They're having a talk like this.
Sure.
Julia Kane and John Kane.
Yeah, there was a previous talk in this room. And lo and behold, serendipity and fate takes its course,
yes.
And then this painting evolves. I'll let you take that away.
Yes.
I'll serve that up to you.
Okay, this was kind of funny. So like, I basically walk in the gallery, and I take a seat next to this woman, and I'm like, you know, I have my coffee, because I always have my coffee. And she's like, oh, Melissa, that smells so good. Is it one of those special drinks? You know, sorry about my voice. Oh, my God, that is not how she sounds. She kind of comes today, but whatever. So I'm just like, oh, no, I think what you're smelling is a mixture of my coffee and my vanilla perfume, you know. And so what kind of perfume do you wear? You know, and she's like, oh, I wear Chanel No. 5. And I was like, oh, well, do you know that Marilyn Monroe is famous for saying that's the only thing she wore then. You know, she just got really coy, and she's like, And now I really, in hindsight, I know she wasn't even coy. I was just reading it as that, you know. She is not coy. You know? And so then, and then I'm like, well, what's your name? And she's like, Gladys Gilson. Oh my God. Like, okay, so first of all, I'm such an art nerd. I don't really get like weird around actors or actresses or people like that, but when it comes to people in the art community and art world at large, I'm just like, I clam up and I'm like, oh my God, if you could ask Gladys Nilsson any question, oh, what would you ask? And I'm just like, oh God, like my mind's racing and I just didn't know what to say. And then John came up and he's like, Gladys Nilsson, nice to meet you. And hey, Julia, how you doing?